other things, and I feel that we're just touching the surface when we speak with Jan Peerce of the wonderful things that he's done over the years. Incidentally, and I asked him before we came on the microphone about this, I can't believe it, but as I said earlier in the broadcast, Jan Peerce has been with us for a considerable time, but tomorrow is his birthday, and he doesn't mind us knowing this because he's written about it in his book and all. He is 75 years of age tomorrow, and that is very hard to believe when you look at Jan Peerce, because he certainly doesn't look that age or anywhere near it.
And hopefully, sir, those who will come to hear me, I hope, will also feel that at my age, I'm still singing with a freshness of voice as a young man. In fact, with added experience because of my maturity, and I will wait for people to tell me what they think. Because I'm a great egomaniac, like all artists, and if I couldn't do it, I would never appear. So I'm proud of being 75 years old, but I say no, 75 years young. Years ago, I sang with Toscanini and with Bruno Walter, and a friend of mine at a party said, well, what is the difference between these two men, two great men, wonderful geniuses? I said, I'll tell you what. Bruno Walter, at that time, was 72 years old. Toscanini was 76 years young. There was a difference in their approach. Both great conductors, both masters, but their approach to their music, their approach to life, their approach to themselves was something that just differed a bit. Toscanini had that fire, that force, that freshness, and Bruno Walter, who was a great musician, he had to go to sleep between 2 and 4 every day. If you try to get a rehearsal, they say, no, I'm anti-musical between 2 and 4.
Right where you're sitting there, a couple of years back, I had the great pleasure of speaking with another, one who is, I think, now about 82 years young and still performing. That's the great Arthur Fiedler.
Oh, he's a remarkable friend of mine.
A remarkable man, isn't he?
Very.
Sure. The leader of the great Boston Pops.
I just sent him a telegram congratulating him. You know, unfortunately, he had been sick, you know.
Yes, I knew he'd been ill, yes.
Made a wonderful recovery. I was in Boston just 3 weeks ago Sunday, and I called him. Unfortunately, he went back to the hospital that day, but I left him a message. Great man.
Other great ones that are many, many years behind them, people that are remarkable, like the great cello player.
Oh, Casals.
Casals.
I sang with him.
You sang with him? I don't suppose there are too many we could drop any name around the place.
Oh, I sang with practically every wonderful, great conductor, musician.
What about Arturo
Toscanini?
The pianist, the great pianist.
Living?
I think he's living.
Oh, Rubinstein.
The same.
Very dear friend of mine.
Oh, now, sure. he, what is he? He's aged.
He's 91, I think.
91.
90, 91.
Is he still performing?
Yes, but not as much as before. He's having trouble, unfortunately, with his vision. But he's a marvelous, great human being, besides being a great pianist. You know, these things have to go together. Just to be a performer and just to have a voice or to play piano or to play the violin is not enough. You must be what we call in German or in Yiddish a mensch. A mensch means a person, but it's the kind of a person that belongs with his fellow man and to not only perform for him, but to be part of his happiness.
The beggar man and the mighty king are only different in name, for they are treated just the same by fate. Today a smile and tomorrow a tear, we're never sure what's in store. So learn your lesson before it is too late. So be like I, hold your head up high,
With his pen, the peasant with his plow. It makes no difference who you are. It's all the same somehow. The king upon his throne, the jester at his feet, the artist, the actress, the man on the street. It's a life of smiles and a life of tears. It's a life of hopes and a life of fears. A blinding torrent of rain and a brilliant burst of sun. A biting, tearing pain and bubbling, sparkling fun. And no matter what you have, don't envy those you meet. It's all the same, it's in the game, the bitter and the sweet. And if things don't look so cheerful, just show a little fight. For every bit of darkness, there's a little bit of light. For every bit of hatred, there's a little bit of love. For every cloudy morning, there's a midnight moon above. So don't you forget, you must search till you find the bluebird. You will find peace and contentment forever if you so remember this, life is no abyss, somewhere there's a bluebird.
Bluebird of happiness, we heard there. And we heard the story of how it was written and why it was written. That particular version, Jan, is the 7th of June 1945. But I heard from a very good record-collecting friend of mine that you recorded that song a lot earlier and under another name.
Yes.
Which I believe was, well, you'd know the name, would you? It was Paul Robinson.
Paul Robinson, yes, sir.
Which is pretty close to Paul Robeson when you come to think of it.
Yes, well, but patterned after another good man.
That's right, yes. Now, how did that come about? Why did you record under another name? I believe you did. You used other names too.
Yes, I also used the name of Randolph Joyce.
Randolph Joyce.
Yeah. Not that I chose the names, but the people who were responsible for my booking, they did it, because I did not want to use my name. For a simple story, I was engaged to do this Bluebird plus four other numbers, I think. And I received a colossal sum of $400 for six numbers and four remakes. And I knew that I'm not going to get any royalties. I knew that this is going into the library of every radio station in the United States and parts of Europe, and all they'll do is play it and play it and play it, And by the time I would get a half a break, Jan Peerce would not be the man to nothing new. You know, you must be new. You must be news from year to year. You can't just say, I did it last year. Mm. So I just got this twist about it, and I said, I'll do it only if you make it under a different name. Now, if we have time, I'd like to tell you a cute story about
sure.
it.
Sure.
I go to Philadelphia quite often, and with the symphony, and their summer concerts in Fairmont Park, the Dell. And they had a wonderful critic who lives in England now, Henry Pleasance, and very well-informed young man, and he studied voice at one time, and we were quite friendly. And this man came into my dressing room before a concert, and he said to me, you know, I told you that when I hear somebody who is as good as you, and maybe even better, I'm going to tell you about it. I said, fine. Who is it? He said, I heard a young voice, he said, and you probably never heard of him. And his name is Paul Robinson. And I think that he's not only as good as you, but in 5 years he's going to be better than you. And with that, with a straight face, I said to him, no, you're absolutely wrong. I don't think he's musical. I don't think he has a beautiful voice. And he, wait a minute, he says, you've never said anything bad about a colleague? You never knocked anybody? Why do you pick a young possible future artist? Why do you? I said, because he's not good. Well, we got into a hassle. My wife, Alice, was witnessing this thing, and of course she knew that I was pulling his leg. He got so angry that he used a couple of words that I can't repeat, and he was about to leave the dressing room, and I called him back. I said, listen, don't be so stupid. I'm the guy you heard. I am Paul Robinson. Well, he says, in that case, then, he says, I'm a pretty good critic.
Beautiful story.
Between the innocence of babyhood and the dignity of manhood, we find a delightful creature called a boy. Boys come in assorted sizes, weights, and colors. But all boys have the same creed: to enjoy every second of every minute of every hour of every day, and to protest with noise, their only weapon, when their last minute is finished, and the adult males pack them off to bed at night. Boys are found everywhere. On top of, underneath, inside of, climbing on, swinging from, running around, or jumping to. Mothers love them. Little girls hate them. Older sisters and brothers tolerate them. Adults ignore them, and heaven protects them. A boy is truth with dirt on its face, beauty with a cut on its finger, wisdom with bubblegum in its hair, and the hope of the future with a frog in its pocket. When you are busy, a boy is an inconsiderate, bothersome, intruding jangle of noise. When you want him to make a good impression, his brain turns to jelly, or else he becomes a savage, sadistic, jungle creature bent on destroying the world and himself with it. A boy is a composite. He has the appetite of a horse, the digestion of a sword swallower, the energy of a pocket-sized atomic bomb, the curiosity of a cat, the lungs of a dictator, the imagination of a Paul Bunyan, the shyness of a violet, the audacity of a steel trap, the enthusiasm of a firecracker, and when he makes something, he has five thumbs on each hand. He likes ice cream, knives, saws, Christmas, comic books, the boy across the street, woods, water in its natural habitat, large animals, dad, trains, Saturday mornings, and fire engines. He is not much for Sunday school, company, schools, books without pictures, music lessons, neckties, barbers, girls, overcoats, adults, or bedtime. Nobody else is so early to rise or so late to supper. Nobody else gets so much fun out of trees, dogs, and breezes.
nobody else can cram into one pocket a rusty knife, a half-eaten apple, 3 feet of string, an empty Bull Durham sack, 2 gumdrops, 6 cents, a slingshot, a chunk of unknown substance, and a genuine supersonic code ring with a secret compartment. A boy is a magical creature. You can lock him out of your workshop, but you can't lock him out of your heart. You can get him out of your study, but you can't get him out of your mind. Might as well give up. He is your captor, your jailer, your boss, and your master. A freckled face, pint-sized, cat-chasing bundle of noise. But when you come home at night with only the shattered pieces of your hopes and dreams, he can mend them like new with the 2 magic words. Hi, Dad.
Honours and awards, Jan. You've had them from the United States, your own country, and abroad. What are some of the awards or honours that you're most proud of?
I can't, now that you put me on the spot, I can't think of all the wonderful awards that
you've been mentioned, for instance, in Congress, haven't you?
Oh, yes.
Written into...
After my Bolshoi visit. Sure.
That's right. You were the first American after World War II
to be invited to sing at the Bolshoi in Russia.
That's right.
Through the graces of our State Department and, of course, the Russian government. And not only did I sing with the Bolshoi, but I was at the Tchaikovsky Hall for my first recital. And there, if you make good at Tchaikovsky Hall, then they invite you to the Conservatory Hall, mm-hmm. which is the honor. And when I was there, I was asked to sing a number in Yiddish or in Hebrew by the ambassador of Israel. And when I did the number, there was much emotion around in my case and then also in the audience. There were only 20% of the audience was Jewish. The rest were all Russian. But they got the feeling of the number, although we told them we had to compare who gave them the meaning in Russian. Mm-hmm. And there was one of the U.S. newspaper men was there, and he wrote an article, and it's now in the Library of Congress. And it ended up, I haven't got too much time to go with, it ended up by saying that it was possible for Jan Peerce to sing a Jewish number in the conservatory for the first time in public in 38 years. There was nobody sang a Jewish number or Hebrew number. And he said, and it was only made possible because his parents, who were born just a short distance away from where this was taking place, had the courage to go to America and seek their fortune there. I'm very proud of that.
Hold my hand and lift mine eyes above. A wider world of hope and joy I see. And sweet, I find the roses waking round my feet, and I am led through tears and joy to thee, because life. and darkness through all time to be, and pray his love may make our love divine, because God made him mine.
Got to talk about Alice. You mentioned Alice. That's your childhood sweetheart. When did you first meet her, Jan?
Oh, my gosh, she was
at school? Was it school?
Not school, no. I met her through a family.
Uh-huh.
I was a great friend of her cousin, her first cousin, and we'd go there. The boys would gather. There was sort of a hangout for us. We'd come in and get some chocolate pudding and a glass of milk and a cookie and things like that, although I was a little beyond the cookie stage. And she used to come down on a Sunday on sort of an excursion. And, in fact, we didn't like each other when we first saw each other. And then... There was a lapse of time, and I met her while I was playing the violin at a wedding, another cousin of hers. And by that time, she had really developed into a beautiful, wonderful, mature-looking girl. And I said, "You are the Alice. Are you the same?" "Yes." And started that way, and here we are.
Here we are.
Now, as long as you're talking years and everything, I'll give you something. May 10th. Just 2 weeks ago,
yes,
Alice and I celebrated our 50th wedding anniversary.
What about that? That's the golden.
Yeah. And it's another thing that I'm very happy about and thankful to God.
You have three children. I wanted to talk so much about that, about Joy and Susan and Larry, the film director.
Of course. Yeah.
Of course. But I'd like to ask about these bird figures that you have at your place. You've got a tutor. You're still in New Rochelle.
Yeah.
And you collect these, you collect modern and pre-Columbian art.
Yes.
But you've got bird
boom.
Figures from all around the world.
We also have a great collection of boom birds. Wherever we go, we travel all over the world, Alice has made it her business to just look around and pick out preferably some sort of a bluebird.
Uh-huh.
But it's gotten beyond, how many bluebirds can you have? So it's gotten beyond that stage. And we have this great, fabulous, wonderful collection.
Do you have an Australian budgerigar, for instance? They're beautiful blues.
I'm sure Alice has it. I'm not
You're not the collector, she is.
No. I admire beautiful things, but she's the knowledgeable one.
That's amazing. Look, we could speak forever, as our producer and recorder said. We could do a series of about 3 or 4 hours. On
that
the
would
life
be nice. I would like
and times of Jan Peerce. Thank you very much for your time. I know you've come all the way down from Sydney for this particular get-together, and we wish you a very, very happy Australian stay, and don't make it 4 or 5 years again before you come back.
Thank you. I will come as soon as I'm re-invited.
They welcomed me, her eyes were fire bright, and then I knew that my path must be through the ever-haunted night. For anywhere I wander, anywhere I roam, till I'm in the arms of my darling again, my heart will find no home. Anywhere I wander, anywhere I roam. Her voice was oh such a soft caress, her love it gently told, and and in her smile was the tenderness I may never more behold. But anywhere I wander, anywhere I roam, till I'm in the arms of my darling again, my heart will find no home. Anywhere I wander, anywhere I roam. Her tears were silver as the morning dew, as she bade me goodbye, and every tear was a promise true that her love would never die. So anywhere I wander, anywhere I roam, till I'm in the arms of my darling again, my heart